Hi guys! Today we are continuing with those tips and tricks that I left out from the first video. If you haven't watched the first tips and tricks video about reptile feeding, I suggest you to do so before you start watching this one. I hope you'll find stuff that you can use for your everyday life in reptile keeping. Enjoy and let's continue! Harvesting food for your herbivorous pets is the best thing you can do. Just make sure you harvest far away from roads or agricultural places where pesticides are used. Read what greens can be offered and search for those in the outdoors. No matter where you collect from, wash the collected herbs first. Collecting insects and other feeders can make you save up some money as well. Every summer I spend countless hours to catch grasshoppers with a net. My Akis love them just as much as they love locusts. Make sure you collect them far away from places where pesticides are used, as it gets into their system by eating the vegetables the chemicals are used for. Other things I collect is earthworms for my fishes. After a heavy rain, you have to just walk around and pick up the worms coming to the surface. I wouldn't advise to offer them to your reptiles because of harmful stuff like parasites or bacteria, but if you really want, keep the worms on wet sponge for about 3 days until the digestive material leaves their system, or just freeze them for a week or two. As much as a meal looks appetizing to you, your reptile may not see it the same way. Those animals in the wild eat not just live animals, they often feed on carrion. Try to add ingredients with strong smell, such as fish or liver. Strong, characteristic scent usually lifts appetite, even for picky eaters. If your reptile refuses to eat for a long period of time, you might want to check if it's not a period where your reptile wants to rest, or breeding season where, for example, males can go off food for a long period of time. Check those periods and make sure if your animal is not in a time frame which can affect its feeding habits. Those can usually be found in detailed animal-specific care sheets. Spraying down the enclosure could also help from time to time. Honestly, I don't know why, but it often gets my animals into the mood to eat, especially the non-tropical species. Try it out yourself and tell us about the results in the comment section. Temporarily changing the usual temperature can help to trigger your animal to eat. Try to cool down or heat up your enclosure a bit for a short period of time before offering a meal. This is something that I do first when I see my reptile go uninterested about food. The very first thing you should check if an animal is not eating well is the baseline conditions you provide. You have to be sure that your animal is under the conditions that the particular species requires. You must check the temperatures, humidity, UV, substrate. Make sure you provide what your animal needs. If everything is right, then you can move on. A well-conditioned animal usually won't give you much trouble when it comes to eating. Breeding your own feeders brings you a lot of benefits. First of all, they are always at your disposal ready for feeding, and it's much cheaper than buying them from someone else. Another benefit is that you know that your feeders are full of nutrients, not starving boxes for days. There are a few species that are super easy to breed, such as crickets, dubia roaches, meal and superworms. Before feeding, always gut load your feeders, so they will be full of nutrients when your reptiles eat them. If you keep your feeders well, they will contribute more when digested. Give your feeders rich, nutritious food a day before you offer them to your animals. If you breed your own feeders, a lot of kitchen waste can be utilized by offering them to your feeders. Crickets, roaches and superworms eat up a lot of left-aside vegetables and fruits, leaving almost nothing to waste. There are some insects which can actually clean themselves from anything you put on them. Crickets, for example, are able to clean all the vitamin dust from their entire body within a few hours if they're not eaten immediately. If you want to leave dusted insects for long in the enclosure, dust locusts, dubia roaches, meal or superworms, they will remain dusted for days. If I want to be 100% sure, I dust grind meat even for my smaller monitors. For my geckos, I dust pinkies or insects. If you have many animals like I do, it's good to make an Excel sheet where you write down which reptile likes what food. After every feeding, I write down the dish and give a score from 1 to 10 depending how much my animals liked it. With this sheet, I can go for the particular food my animals like and don't have to throw uneaten food away. Freezing food is not a bad thing. I always make more than my animals can eat and freeze what is left for busy days. There are times when it's good to just defrost some food without the need to make fresh one or buy fresh. I'm talking about stuff I make, for example homebrew from my skinks, or fruits, simple meat or rodents. Insects I never try to freeze, I'm curious if any one of you did. Just to feed your animals is not enough. You have to offer a somewhat balanced diet in order to maintain a good health. Make sure your reptile gets everything it needs from a balancing standpoint. Watch vitamin and calcium supplementation as much as a good balance of protein, fat, and fibers. Read about your feeders and see what they offer to your animal. It's not a hard thing, you have to just take the time for designing a good diet.